Now that I've defined a person of interest, it's time to get our hands dirty with the data set. So here's the path that I followed to find the data set. I started on Google, as I always do. When I Google for Enron emails, the first thing that pops up is the Enron email data set. You can see that it's a data set that's very famous. Many have gone before us in studying this for many different purposes. It has its own Wikipedia page. It has a really interesting article that I recommend you read from the MIT Technology Review about the many uses of this data set throughout the years. But the first link is the data set itself. Let's follow that link. This takes us to a page from the Carnegie Mellon CS department that gives a little bit of background on the data set. And then if we scroll down a little ways, we see this link right here. This is the actual link to the data set. Below that is a little bit more information. If you click on this, it's going to download a TGZ file, which you can see I've already downloaded down here. If you do this on your own, it took me nearly half an hour to download the whole data set, so I recommend that you start the download and then walk away to do something else. Once you have the data set, you'll need to unzip it, so move it into the directory where you want to work, and then you can run a command like this. There's no real magic here, I just Googled how to unzip .tgz and found a command like this. Again, this will take a few minutes. When you're done with that, you'll get a directory called Enron Mail, and then cd into maildir. Here's the data set. It's organized into a number of directories, each of which belongs to a person. You see that there's so many here, I can't even fit them all on one page. In fact, you'll find that there's over 150 people in this data set. Each one is identified by their last name and the first letter of their first name. So looking through on a very superficial level, I see Jeff Skilling. Let's see if I can find Ken Lay. Looks like he might be up here. Yep, there's Ken Lay. Of course, a whole bunch of people I've never heard of. And remember, my question is, how many of the persons of interest do I have emails from? Do I have enough persons of interest that I have their emails that I could start describing the patterns in those emails using supervised classification algorithms? And so the way that I answered this question was, again, using some work by hand, basically. I took my list of persons of interest, and for each person on that list, I just looked for their name in this directory. Let's go back to that. Remind ourselves what it looked like. You can see the annotated list here. You might have been wondering what these letters were before each of the names. These were my notes that I wrote to myself as to whether I actually have the inbox of each of these people. So Ken Lay and Jeff Skilling we already found, but then it started to become a little bit more difficult. So you can see there are many, many people that I have N's next to their name, and that means no, I don't have, for example, Scott Yeager. If I go over to the data set, I don't see a Yeager down here. So Scott Yeager is a person who I'd love to have his inbox. I'd love to have some emails to and from him, but I don't. As it turns out, I don't have the email inboxes of a lot of people. So I'll be honest, at this point, I was actually really discouraged about the possibility of using this as a project at all. I think I counted something like 4 or 5 people that I had their inboxes. And while that might be a few hundred emails or something like that, there's really no chance that with 4 examples of persons of interest, I could start to describe the patterns of persons of interest as a whole. In the next video, though, I want to give you a key insight that I had that gave this project a second chance, a different way of trying to access the email inboxes of the persons of interest.